Okay, here are CNC principles. So we've been seeing a lot of CNC equipment through the semester. So CNC stands for computer numerical control, and this is essentially machine tools that are controlled by computers. Okay, so all these tool paths, instead of being initiated with turning hand wheels and things like that, all of this is done with motors under the control of a computer. So some of the advantages, as you can imagine, this is a much faster way because you don't have to stop and carefully adjust the machine. All of that happens automatically. It is accurate, it's repeatable, and it's agile and adaptable. And really, this is the one that distinguishes CNC from other older types of automation. So there were, as we saw earlier in the semester, screw machines, you know, in the turn of the century, well, 1905, 1910, in that area, there were screw machines that operated pretty darn fast. They were also accurate and repeatable. Now, when you compare it to, like, manual equipment, maybe, manual equipment was not all that accurate, not all that repeatable. But screw machines were these things. But the thing that is really revolutionary about CNC is this fact. That is that it's agile and adaptable. You see, to program a screw machine, you had to machine cams and things like that. To program a CNC machine, it just takes a change of a digit in a program. So much, much easier to adapt. You can run one type of part on a CNC machine for one part number, that's one geometry, and the very next part can be completely different. Doesn't have to be really related to the first one at all. So the way this works, kind of at a 1,000 foot view, is you take a program. So this is where the human interfaces with the works. So the human programs this code over here, and really there's a separate layer of sort of abstraction from this. You can use something called CAM software, computer-aided manufacturing software, that takes a computer model, a CAD model of some three-dimensional shape that you want to machine, and helps you to write this code. But anyway, at this point, this is where the human kind of interacts, where the operator kind of interacts with the machine. This program is actually encoded. This is ones and zeros sorted out together for us to be able to make some sense out of them. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a minute. But anyway, the result of this is actually a binary code that goes into the machine controller. So at the controller, what the controller does is it parses all of this and it divides it up and it turns it, checks the logic that's there. And it does some math. So here we've asked it perhaps to go to the origin, to x0, y0. Well, the controller needs to know where the tool is located and it needs to do the math to figure out how fast to turn the different motors so that it winds up at this x0, y0 point that we've commanded. And it does that math, it does all that logic, and then it sends a signal out. And there's really extra another piece here where you tie into sort of the mains electrical power from your logic, and that is a motor controller. So the motor controller that you don't really see pictured here takes and converts this logic that comes out of the controller into actual power that powers these servo motors. And I say servo motors, they can be different types of motors, but in a industrial CNC, it typically is some kind of a DC servo motor. And then optionally, there is this feedback loop, and we'll talk a little bit about this later, but most industrial CNC machinery is going to have a feedback loop here. And what that does is you say you command the motor to go make enough turns so that you move the table, say, an inch. Okay, some types of motors, like we'll see here in just a second, a stepper motor, you just send the power to the motor and you hope that the motor turns enough to move the table 1 inch. But in a servo system, you actually measure the amount of movement that the table moved, and you compare it, or the servo system compares where it's supposed to be to where it actually is through this feedback loop. And what it has is essentially encoders on the axes, and those encoders measure how far the table actually moved. So with a servo system, you will have this feedback loop. All right, so I mentioned that the computer uses binary numbers. It uses binary numbers not just for the numbers themselves, but also all of the letters and characters all have their own codes. So this is the way that this code works. You've got these binary numbers, okay? So we're used to decimal numbers. That is, we count from, we have zero, and then we count from 1 through 10, and you can do that on your fingers, you see. And then when you need to go to 11, you have to kind of start over. Well, binary numbers only have the digits 1 and 0. So you go 0, and then once you get to 1, you have to move to 10. So 1, 0 would be 10. So you only have the numbers 1 and 0 that are available to you. It's either this or it's that. It's either 1 or it's a 0. And the way this works nicely with computers and with CNC equipment is that you can emulate this with switches, okay? Not literal switches, but transistors that act as switches, for example, or relays. But you've got, you can say that if you have these different bits here, and you can say that this first position is worth 2 to the 0th power, okay? So that would be 1, in other words. Then this second position would be worth 2. So the way that you count in binary is you have 1, and then we turn that off, we'd turn this on, and we would have 2. And then if we wanted 3, we would have both of these enabled. So we would have 2 and 1, and that would give us 3. Then if we wanted to count to 4, we'd turn these two off, and we would turn the 4 on. If we wanted 5, we would leave the 4 on, leave the 2 off, and turn the 1 on. Okay, so this combination allows us to have numbers, 0 through 9, but then, how many is this? 16? We can get all the way to 32 with just this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bits, okay? This is kind of the structure of binary. And like I said, you can have all of the numbers, 1, 0 through 9, but you can also have letters. So we'll say the number 88 could correspond to the letter X. You may be familiar with the ANSI, the ASCII character code. So you can represent more than just numbers. You can represent end of block characters, exclamation marks, all kinds of characters. Any character you can type, you could represent with binary. You just have to agree before you start that a certain number means a certain letter, and things like that. All right, so this is the way that it used to look. In the early days of CNC programming, a program was actually punched into punch tape. I've got some of this punch tape around the office here. If you just, I'll try to bring some to class if we ever have class again. But anyway, this feeds into the, or fed into the computer, and it would read the where the bits were punched out. Okay, so if there wasn't a bit punched out, that would count as a 0, and if there was a bit punched out, then that would be a 1. So this whole row across here is not just, this is just a single character, okay? So like down here, it's spelled out for you. This is the number 1, this is the number 2, this is the number 3. Now, and you can see it's counting the way that I said. You have 1, and then for 2, you have just the 2. For 3, you have the 2 and the 1. Now, you also have this bit here, and I'll talk just a minute about that. But anyway, what you had here is punch tape code. And so when you fed this to the computer, this would literally, it would read in here a plus symbol, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, Y, plus symbol 6, 7, 8, 9, 0, end of block. Okay, so this is the way that the code used to be structured. It was literally on tape, and really nothing's changed since then. you know, there are different protocols and different ways of encoding the information here, but we still do this with ones and zeros. We just, they're either magnetically stored or they're stored as little pits in a CD and things like that, but they're still the same idea. And one of the things that comes up when you're trying to get CNC machines to talk to computers and things like that is the communication protocol is not always, it's not always exactly the same. You know, we're pretty used to these days computers being able to talk to each other with things like USBs or with network cables. When we go to the internet, we don't worry about the parity bits or the stop bits or anything like that. But with sort of older technology and with sort of technology that you have a little more control over, you do have to worry about those things. So here's just an example. And I said, you know, I would mention why this bit was here. You'll notice if we count the number of bits, the number of enabled bits, the number of ones, essentially, the number of holes in this punch tape, we'll see that this row 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is an odd number. You'll also see that this row 3 is odd. 1 is odd. 1 is odd. 3 is odd. 1 is odd. 3 is odd. This is odd. This is odd. Every line on here is odd. And what that is an example of error checking. So this P bit here is called the parity bit. And if we have odd parity enabled, then any row of dots on here should have an odd number of holes in it. You say, well, that's a whole waste of a bit. Why would you do that? Well, remember this was made out of paper, and if you had something like a little a bookworm or a moth or something come in here and eat a hole out of here, you could not just get the wrong program, you could crash the machine, okay? So it's very important, and we'll see in just a little bit that it's able to, that you can crash a machine by just leaving out a decimal place, for instance. So that's really one of the lessons for today, is that that you have to be very, very careful with CNC programming, because one small mistake can be very expensive. Also, it's very easy to make a very small mistake. And a small mistake, well, there's this thing I call the law of the vice, and that is that if there's a difference between what you think a program's going to do when it runs and what it actually does, there will be a large piece of metal in the way that you will ram into. So just keep that in the back of your mind. All right, so let's see. We see that all these symbols get grouped together into a program, okay? And the way that they're grouped is pretty important. So we've talked about what binary means, so I'm going to skip past that. But the way that G code, and that's the language that we're talking about here, and that's NGC, what is it? RS-274 is the language, essentially. It's a standard language. But there are some differences by manufacturers. There's enough flexibility in the standard language that not all CNC machines execute it the exact same way. But there's some logic to the way that you group together all of these symbols to make a valid code. The symbols are grouped together into blocks, and they get executed block by block. But inside this block is what we call word address format. So a word is an example of X20. All of this goes together, and it all gets analyzed together. So when the controller sees X, it expects only to see some value of a number after that. If you have X and then following it you have Y, it will throw an error, because that's not what it expects. It expects to see the letter X, and after the X, it wants to see some parameter. In this case, it has to be some kind of a number up to 4 decimal places. These word address words get grouped into blocks, and this is the way that the code gets executed. It gets executed block by block, and I'll talk a little bit about what I mean by that in just a few minutes. We talked about what the controller is. We talked a little bit about motors, open loop and closed loop. I didn't mention stepper motors. You will see sometimes stepper motors on less expensive machines. You will see them on 3D printers, which are in fact sort of a type of CNC machine. Most CNC printers execute G code. Sometimes they don't show you the G code because they want you to think it's some kind of proprietary language, and sometimes they encode that G code so you can't see it. But most of the time, that's what it is. So, but anyway, small CNC machines, little hobby CNC machines, and 3D printers will tend to use these types of motors called stepper motors. And they have these two parts, a rotor in the middle that rotates, and a stator on the outside that doesn't rotate, remains stationary. And what you can do is energize the coils in that stepper motor and align the rotor to those coils. And you can energize these in steps so that the motor moves a certain number of steps. You can also do things like half-stepping and micro-stepping where you go in between steps. But that's a stepper motor. There's a really nice little video that somebody did, Hawkins did a pretty nice little 3D printed stepper motor, and you can see pretty plainly how this thing works. Okay, you energize a series of coils, and you can position the motor left, right, and you can move it some number of steps. But like I said, most CNC machines will use a servo motor that incorporates a feedback loop. All right, now here's a major difference between CNC machines and manual machines. In manual machines, the motion control is handled by a lot of times Acme lead screws, and sometimes these Acme lead screws allow a little bit of backlash. So if you were able to, and if you're in my class, well, that needs to go away. You used a manual machine, and most of those machines are pretty bad about having backlash. So let me show you what backlash is. Here's the lead screw, say, on a lathe. And let's say this is the cross slide feed. When you turn the screw in one direction, it pushes the cross slide forward. Okay, so you can see that the teeth are meshed nicely, or almost meshed nicely there. Let me adjust that a little bit. All right, so the teeth are meshed nicely like that. And when you turn the lead screw this way and it moves that the cross slide forward, you can have a pretty good adjustment. You can dial in a thousandth of an inch or so. But when you reverse things and when you get ready to go the other direction, you see you move the lead screw over, it goes through this period where it's not actually moving the cross slide. And then, of course, you know it engages and then it starts moving. This amount of motion that you can get inside here, back and forth, is called the backlash. All right. So, and like I said, in manual machines, it's not a huge deal. You can, you just expect it, and you work around it, and you can tighten it out a little bit to some degree. But it's almost always there, at least a little bit. Okay. So, it's important to understand what backlash is, and there are different ways of dealing with backlash, but the really great way of dealing with it is to use a device called a ball screw. So let me just come back over here. If we were to try to deal with the backlash in this case by, you know, one way to do it, let me just see if I can do this without too much difficulty. One way to do it is to actually split this nut in two and have a spring that presses the two halves apart. Let me just move that over a little bit. Okay, so you can have a spring inside of here that mashes, so you split this nut in two, and now you have pressure against both sides of the lead screw. The problem is you have a lot more friction, okay? One real nice way to solve that problem is to use this thing called a ball screw. This is from SKF. Whoops, didn't mean to go all the way out. But you can see that now when a ball screw rotates, it moves the nut back and forth. There is no backlash, and the friction is almost eliminated. So a very, very nice, elegant solution. And you see the balls have to recirculate like this because they're always in rolling contact with both the nut and the shaft side, both the screw and the nut. And so since they're in rolling contact, then eventually they would roll out. And so what you do is you just recirculate them. So that's a pretty major difference. All right, let's take a peek at some CNC programming. Okay, so one thing that I want you to realize as we go through this is that a little knowledge can be a dangerous thing. And nowhere is that more plainly the case than in CNC programming. Okay, you really need to know what you're doing. This is just a a very, very rough introduction, okay? All right, so first of all, you should hopefully be aware of they call it the coordinate plane. It's the Cartesian coordinate system, okay? And that is you have this x-axis, you have a y-axis, and you'll also have a z-axis at least, and maybe some others, okay? And what we can do on our CNC machine is we can tell the machine where we want the origin to be for the coordinate system that we're going to use. Okay, so we'll name it something like G54. Okay, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But let's just say that we have assigned this corner of the vise to be our coordinate system origin. You'll notice it's a little funny because we're not in the first quadrant. This is quadrant one. This is the second quadrant, the third quadrant, and the fourth quadrant. The reason that we're in the fourth quadrant is, well, we don't have a choice over which way is negative and which way is positive. This way is going to be positive. This way is going to be negative. And this jaw of the vise moves. Okay, so if we want to fix the coordinate system down on something solid that's not going to move around, we'll use this fixed jaw of the vise. And so a lot of times it's very common to program here in this fourth quadrant so that all of your x's are positive and all your y's are negative, for example. But some of the main things to notice is that we can tell the machine this is where we want the origin to be. So what you look for on a machine tool, let me see if I can find a little better picture. Hang on. All right, while that's loading up, I'll just talk. All right, so the thing you look for, first of all, is the spindle. Okay, so if it's a lathe, then you've got this great big spindle, typically horizontal. You've got, on a mill, you've got this spindle right here. The spindle, or the main spindle, or the biggest spindle, is typically going to be the z-axis. So you'll tend to look for that first of all. All right, so here's our machine tool. And like I said, the spindle is going to be our z-axis. So moving up and down, let me just do that. Moving up and down is going to be our z motion. Okay, so yes, that's fine. All right, so we come up and down. That's z motion. And when the tool moves up, that's our positive direction. So that's the first thing to look for, is the z-axis. Now, on our machine tool, the next axis is going to be the x-axis. So that's back and forth in this direction. Let me just move this in the x direction. I'll show you what I'm talking about. Okay, so we move left and right in the x direction. I don't want you to be confused by this, but I want you to notice that when we move in this direction, look how it looks like the tool is moving. Don't look at what's actually moving. That is the vise there on the table. When I'm moving in this direction, it looks like the tool is moving to the right. All right, even though the table's moving to the left. So this direction, as we go here from negative 20 to negative 5 to 0, that's the positive direction, okay? So even though the table's moving in what looks like it's going from right to left, we always position our thoughts based on how the tool is moving, okay? So this is positive tool motion. If I zoom in here a little bit, and you just maybe pretend that it's only the tool that's moving, you'll see that the tool's moving in the positive x direction. And of course, the other axis is the y axis in this direction. Same situation. So this is the y moving in the negative direction, and this is the y moving in the positive direction, okay? Because that's the way that the tool would be moving. All right, and that will make a little bit more sense later on as we get to. All right, so first find the x-axis, and then first find the z-axis. That's going to be the spindle. Then the x-axis is going to be usually parallel to the floor and usually the longest axis. Okay, so in our example here, this motion back and forth, this thing is going to move left and right in the x-axis, and then the y-axis is going to be moving in and out. They're all at 90 degrees to each other. We say that's orthogonal. And we can also have rotary motion, okay? So we have, let's see. Well, anyway, you know they follow the right-hand rule. And there are two different ways you can do the right-hand rule. You can make the x-axis your thumb, and then y is your index finger, and your middle finger is z. It works that way. Or you can do it the way that it's drawn there. That one I kind of like because you always find the Z first. So point your finger or thumb in the positive Z direction. Then your index finger will be the positive X direction if it's properly rotated. And then you look for Y to be perpendicular to X and Z. Also, you can have rotary motion. Here we have a rotary table installed on this mill. So rotary motion, from the tool's perspective, is rotating in this direction. Okay, so I should say there are three letters that identify rotary motion, and that's A, B, and C. And these follow with each other. A is rotation about the X axis, B is rotation about the Y axis, and C is rotation about the Z axis. They always pair up alphabetically. Later on, you'll see we have U, V, W, I, J, K. They all correspond alphabetically like that. All right, now let's take a look at some code. The first code that we'll look at is G01 or G1 code. And when the controller sees G1, it will expect to see an X, a Y, and or a Z. And then behind each of those numbers, or each of those letters, it'll expect to see some number generally to four decimal places. Okay, and the decimal place here is important. We'll talk a little bit about that later. Also, it has to have a feed rate because a G01 will do is move at a linear move at a feed rate. So the first time that you ask for a G01, you have to supply a feed rate, and that's in inches per minute. Well, in general, if you're in inch mode. All right, so this, if we just put this code in the controller, it might just do what we expect it to do. On the other hand, it might do something completely different. Okay, and that's because there are a lot of settings that can be changed in the controller by the last code that ran on the machine. You see, we could take this code, put it in the controller, and it might do exactly what we thought, and then we can come back later the next day on the exact same machine and run this code again, and it will wreck. Okay, so I'm not going to talk about all of that today. I'm just going to talk about one example. So let's just see two different ways that this same code could execute. All right, and that is going to depend on whether a G91 code comes before this or a G90 code comes before this. So let's execute this two different ways. Okay, let's first of all, we'll run this as if there's a G90 code that comes right before this G1 code here. Okay, so it says G91, and then it switches to G90 mode. Okay, G90 mode is absolute mode. Okay, in other words, it's like if I said go to mile marker 120 on Interstate 40 in the state of Tennessee, that's going to take you to a specific spot. Okay, so that's an absolute method. If we have incremental on, that's like saying get on Interstate 40 in the state of Tennessee and go 120 miles. It doesn't matter where you are. Say I call you up on your cell phone, I say go to mile marker 120. If you happen to be at mile marker 130, you only have to go 10 miles to get there. But if I say get on Interstate 40 in Tennessee and go, say, west 120 miles, then you have to go 120 miles to do that thing. Okay, so let's first look at this. Now, one thing that's not included in this code is where the actual spindle is located right now. Let's just say that the spindle is located right, let me put it right there for right now. Okay, so the spindle just happens to be right there, and we execute this G90 code. Okay, so we say G90, that puts the controller into absolute mode, and when we run the program, we'll get something like this. It's going to go here in the first line to 00, and then the second line is going to go to X2Y0, so that's over 2 and up none, and then it's going to go to X2Y2, so it's going to go over 2 and up 2, and then it's going to go to X0Y2, it's going to go to that point, and then finally it's going to go back to there. That's probably what you expected. But let's do it again, and this time let's switch out and I don't have any way to erase that G90 out of there, but let's just say that G90 goes a one, it goes away, and we have G91 in control. Let me just change this color. We'll make this happen in blue, and instead of having G90, we'll have G91. G91, and let me just separate those two, and let me turn that into blue so it all makes good sense. And let's just say that we're starting at the same spot, all right, right there. So now it says X0, Y0. What that says is don't move the X-axis and don't move the Y-axis. And so we wind up right back where we started from. So we're still here. Then it says go in the X2 and go up 0. So we go over 2 and up 0. And then it says go X2, Y2. So that's over 2, over 1, 2, and up 2. Okay? And you see that it's actually gone in the diagonal. That's because it's executing block by block. Okay, so it says X2, Y2, all in one block, and so it's going to make a diagonal. Then it says move the X none and move the Y 2. So we go up 2 in the Y, and then finally it says X0, Y0, and we're done. So notice we have two completely different paths depending on whether we have G91 enabled or G90 enabled. Okay, so here's where the law of device comes in. If you thought it was going to go like G90 did there, then what you're going to have is a big old vice right there that it's going to go crashing through. All right, so let me just hasten to make that point. All right, moving right along. I did say that we could assign a specific point on the machine. We could tell the machine that this is where we want our origin to be. And we can have multiples of those. We could have this vice could be, say, G54. This vice could be G55. Okay. So in this example, it's just kind of showing you what how you tell that to the compute, how you tell the CNC machine where that place is. Okay. And the way that works is I've got there's a link out to another from my CNC class where I actually talk about how this happens in a little bit more detail. But what you're seeing here is this is stored in the controller. These numbers are stored in the controller. What are those numbers? Those numbers are where the machine is in its own coordinate system. Okay, so let me just take this machine to its home position, and that is we'll take this so that in the machine home, this is in the 0 point. That's the x-axis all the way homed, and we'll move the y-axis to its home position. That's 0 there. Yeah, all right, close enough. And we'll take the z-axis home, okay? So I'm going to actually move it to 0. Our machine actually downstairs actually homes out at positive 4 or something. But anyway, there, I'm going to call that close enough. All right, so what that is, that's the machine origin. That's the machine at this point, kind of in space out there. That is where the machine is all the way at its home. And it has limit sensors on the machine that let it know where it is in reference to the home position. Okay, so whenever we tell the machine to go someplace, it's always thinking in terms of its own home position, of its own coordinate system, the machine coordinate system. So if I move this table, let me just move it over to some position, and we'll just say we want to call this our G54 position, then it will record that as some distance in its own machine coordinate system. Yeah, let me get out of that. Okay, and this is actually stored in the controller, so I go and I jog the machine. We use our edge finders or whatever tools we have to find the edge of this vise or the edge of this block. And we tell the machine this is where we want G54 to be located. And what it will do is store in its machine coordinates for that point. Okay. So once we've asked for G54 through G59, then the machine knows where we want our origin to be. It knows where we want to actually machine. And that will make a lot more sense, make it easier to program. So I'm just going to drop back to this slide and show you that's how you position your coordinate system at a known spot on the machine. So now we can program, and we can say if we wanted to actually move the tool to this point, we could say G54, and then we'd say G1, X, positive 1, Y, negative 1, and it would position right above this spot. And then we could, depending on how we have our Z axis set, we could say Z0, and it would bring this tool all the way down and position the tool at that exact spot. All right, so back to where we were. All right, so these are some of the codes that you need to learn, okay? G1, we already talked about how that works. That just moves in a straight line at a particular feed rate. We talked about what G90 and G91 mean, the difference between those two. We talked about the difference between G54 through G59. That is where we position our origin. So we ask for these in the code. Let me see if I've got some code here. Let's see here. There, he's asking for G55. Okay, so in that code, he says G55, and that sets, depending on where that's manually set on the machine, that sets the origin. One thing we didn't talk about is G00, and that's a rapid move. Let me just talk about what's scary about a rapid move. If we had, let's just say, let me get rid of some of this off of here. Let's say that we're right here, okay? And we say G00, X0, Y0 from where we are. All right, so let's just add that. Let's say we're G90, we say G0, and really you can just get away with G0. I like G00, we'll say X0, Y0. Okay, so we're gonna execute this code. I'm just gonna make this all the same color because I'm not gonna do any comparison, okay? Now, I will make our line hidden because that's typically how you would draw a rapid line. What you might expect is this. Okay, you might expect it to just go at full speed. So since it's a rapid move, we don't have a feed rate. G00, X0, Y0, you might expect it to do that. Okay, but in actuality, what it's going to do is this. It's going to start here. It's going to run both the X motor and the Y motor as fast as it possibly can. And then the Y motor is going to run out, and the X motor is going to finish up. Okay, so if you didn't know that that's what's going to happen, and you thought that it was going to go in a straight line from there to there, obviously the law of the vise is going to mean that the vise is going to be located right there, and you're going to smash into it. Okay, so this is what a G0 path looks like. They tend to run in 45 degrees until one axis runs out, and then it finishes up the other axis. So what it does, it doesn't just run, it doesn't move in a straight line as fast as it can. It moves both motors as fast as it can move them. So that's a rapid move, and it's important to understand the difference there. Okay, so we've learned how to read some code. We know what X, Y, Z mean. We know A, B, and C. Those are rotary axes. We didn't talk about U, V, and W, but those could be used, for instance, in a wire EDM, which we haven't even talked about. So we'll talk about that later. Do notice that the decimal point is important, okay? 2.0 is not the same thing as 2. All right, and this depends on your controller, but this is the typical thing. Most of the time, if you say 2, the way that the computer will interpret that, if you just say 2 without the decimal place, it's going to think this, 0.0002, 2 tenths, 2 ten thousandths of an inch, which notice that's a lot different from 2.0, okay? So the number 2 is 2 tenths, 2.0 is 2 inches, and that goes back to when punch tape was expensive and you wanted to eliminate a lot of code if you want to make a whole lot of little tiny moves in a row to make some smooth shapes and things. You didn't want to have to keep saying use up a whole lot of punch tape on decimals, so you just placed the decimal automatically and used the number 2. Much shorter punch tape when you had a bunch of little tiny incremental moves. All right, I think that's all except for N, and N was just is just used for line numbers. Okay, so you'll see some of that typically you don't use line numbers unless you have a reason to, which we'll talk about in the other class. Okay, 4476. All right, so this looks a little bit cryptic. It's a little hard to understand until you realize that most of the stuff up here is kind of boilerplate that gets repeated a whole lot depending on what company you work for and the way they set their machines up. It's just kind of safety code to make sure that the machine always behaves the same way when it starts off. Here we're just asking for a tool and a tool offset, and we didn't even talk about what tool offsets are, but you're only responsible for what we did talk about. Here he asks for a tool change, then he turns the spindle on, and he makes a rapid move to a certain point, and then he makes a linear move to these different points. Okay. Now, whether it is absolute or incremental, what's that depend on? G90 or G91? We have to go back, and the first one that we get to as we go back is G90. Okay. So we're in G90 mode. So you see, this is once you get past the first bit up here, most of it is X, Y, and Z. The stuff in parentheses is those are just notes. Those are just for a human. The computer completely ignores what's inside the parentheses. All right, so that's about it for the day. If you made it this far, I'd like for you to know about this test question that you may see. This is going to ask you whether these different punch tapes are set up for even, odd, or no parity. And the way you can tell is go through here. That's an even number. That's an even number. That's an even number. Even, even, even. That's even parity. Odd, 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 odd. And here it's a mix. So this is even, odd, and no parity.